Hello everyone, this is MJ with MinIO. In this video, we're going to talk about running MinIO on Docker single node with multiple drives mounted inside the Docker container. So we're going to talk about what is single node multi-drive MinIO, and we're going to talk about that from the pure Linux sense, because that is the documentation that is on the website. But then we're going to show you how you can do that within Docker. You lose some of the fidelity there because Docker does some obfuscation. And if you actually lose a drive, Docker will just mount it on the local system. But it's still more reliable than just a Docker configuration with a single drive backing it. Again, this is for testing and development only. Do not use this configuration in production. But I know a lot of people, much like myself, when you're doing testing or development, you like to be able to bring things up very quickly with Docker. And I try to Dockerize all of my systems when I'm running multiple different pieces to emulate what it might look like operating in a full-blown environment. So we want to make sure that we can clean up behind ourselves, and Docker gives you a really easy way to do that. So I understand why you might want to do all of this in Docker. We will have future courses where I will show you a single node, multi-drive native deployment on Linux. So make sure you're on the lookout for that. So once I've showed you how to deploy this single node, multi-drive MinIO on top of Docker, we're going to show you how to validate the container status, make sure everything looks good inside those containers, connecting to the MinIO service itself using both the UI as well as the MC client, and then deploying MinIO single node multi-drive with Docker Compose. We're actually going to do that full Docker Compose. So if you've watched the previous videos in the series, I showed you how to do this from the command line. We're completely abandoning that. These commands get far too complex to really make them meaningful from the command line directly. So we're just going to use Docker Compose for this. Here is the documentation for the Linux native single node multi-drive. And all I've done is taken this and adapted it to work with Docker. But this is really the way, if you want this to be a much more robust and much more long-lived environment, you should follow this method of deploying this on top of something like Linux and using multiple drives attached to that Linux host. So let's talk about single node multi-drive with Docker. The procedures on this page cover deploying MinIO in a single node multi-drive configuration. So single node means one node, so that's a single point of failure, so you need to be careful about that. And then also multiple drives, which means you could lose a drive. So if you have some flaky drives that you want to use for this and you don't necessarily trust them, but you need to keep this data around at least for your testing, this is a great way to go. It provides drive level reliability, as I was saying, and failure recovery with performance and scaling limitations imposed by a single node. So essentially, as much throughput as you can get on a single node, knowing that if the single node goes down, this environment's gone. So that's why we stress that this is dev and test only. For production environments, we strongly recommend deploying multi-node, multi-drive, so basically a distributed topology, and there will be some future videos on that as well. So be on the lookout for that. As I said, the key here is that the single node multi-drive deployment provides limited drive level only reliability. So again, if you lose that node, your stuff is gone. Long-lived dev test environments are perfect for this, for development and learning. You can use this to test newer versions of MinIO to ensure that they work as you expect across multiple drives, or test new features in newer versions. So you're gonna be able to see how the erasure code actually splits the files up and puts them on different drives for availability and things like that using this tool. So let's talk about the disk setup that I'll be using in this configuration. Note that you're gonna need some, in this case, Linux experience to really understand this and understand how yours needs to be mounted. If you're using some sort of virtualization system, the UUIDs or the mappings for your drives might change. So follow your own internal documentation to make sure that you're mapping these properly. Don't necessarily just follow along with what I'm doing here, because if you reboot that host, you stop that host and bring it back online, the mappings may get mixed up. So make sure that you are familiar with the configuration on your end and understand exactly how these mappings need to go. So we strongly recommend a direct attached JBOD arrays with XFS formatted disks for the best performance. Using any other type of storage, whether it's SAN, NAS, ext4, RAID, LVM, you incur some overhead there. There's a performance hit, and there's also reliability and predictability and consistency things that you have to consider here. So if you're trying to not use basically a pure block device disk as the underlying here, then you may run into either some issues with that, where it just doesn't work like you expect it to, or it might just be slow. So for the disk setup, ensure that all server drives for which you intend MinIO to use are of the same type. So that's important. MinIO does not distinguish between what types of drives. So if you have a 1 terabyte drive in there that's a SSD and you have another one that's a hard drive, you're going to be impacted because they are different speeds. Additionally, MinIO limits the size used per drive to the smallest drive in the deployment. So if you have a 4 terabyte hard drive and 2 or 3 1 terabyte SSDs or NVMe drives, you're not going to get the full capacity out of that 4 terabyte drive. It's going to limit it to essentially 1 terabyte. So that's basically lost space for this configuration. Now, for dev and test, you might not care. You might just need 4 drives. But again, you shouldn't be mixing them anyway. So make sure they're all of the same size. Here's some documentation links. We'll put these in the description below so that you can kind of follow along and understand MinIO's methodology on using the local just a bunch of disks or JBOD configuration with sequential mounts. So now let's talk about deploying single node multi-drive MinIO with Docker. This is important. MinIO requires using the expansion notation. So you're going to get the curly braces with some drive number. So the X could be 1 and the Y could be 4 here. So that would give you 4 total drives. And that's the denotation you need to use when you're defining this in order to pass this along to MinIO. You cannot define them individually. You have to define them in this exact notation for this to work. Additionally, formatting disks and adding them to the etc fstab, MinIO requires that the ordering of the physical drives remain constant. This is what I was saying earlier. If you restart your systems and you have not configured your fstab correctly, or if you have not pointed at the right UUIDs for your volumes and they get rearranged somehow in this, then it's going to cause problems and basically will not work. So your MinIO deployment in Docker or even on the local system, if you're running this natively, will essentially fail because the drive order will change and MinIO will be expecting a certain drive with certain information at a certain location that's mounted in here. And if it comes up and changes for some reason, it's going to break your deployment. So be careful with this. So here's an example of the configuration from our website. So you'll see the make FS XFS on all of the disks that are listed here. And then you will basically take those labels and mount them inside the etc fstab. So as you reboot, those come back online in the same order. This might be different for you. You can use labels, but you can also use UUIDs within your disk system and also mount those in there. So you need to be familiar with Linux concepts to really get this right for your environment. So we will create an environmental variable file. We'll create this file at etc default minio. And for Windows hosts, this will be at C MinIO config or something like that. MinIO server container can use this file as the source of all environmental variables. So we will be essentially mounting this file inside the container using Docker Compose. Here's a sample of this environmental variable file, links in the description. But you can see here that we are defining the root user and password. And we are also using that notation that we mentioned earlier on this line next to MinIO volumes. You can see it's mount data disk and then curly braces 1 through 4. Here's a sample of the Docker Compose file that we will use. If you've watched the previous videos, you should be familiar with this by now, but you can see that there's the MinIO common over here. And you can see that we are saying mount the disks 1 through 4 under the command. And we're exposing ports 9000 and 9090 from the container to the host. And then we're doing a health check on that. And then over here on the right, if you'll notice, we have more mounts than we had before. So in this case, we are mounting every single disk in here, whatever you've named them, into the container itself. So we have to mount all of these from the host system inside the Docker container, as well as that configuration file you see at the bottom right here. So let's talk about validating the container status now. When you run Docker Compose up minus D, which is for detached, remember you should run the minus D because otherwise you will be dropped into the terminal and basically you will see the streaming output logs and you'll have to control C to get out of this. And then when you type Docker Compose logs, you'll see all of the logs from that container. So you'll be able to quickly see if there's any issues in there, if it's throwing any errors, if it doesn't like the configuration you've provided it, and you can go and then troubleshoot from there. It should return something similar to this if you run the logs command and there are no errors, where you can see that it is showing you the container address. So that's at 10.0.2.100 in this case. And remember that you don't want to use the container address to access this. You need to be using your host address. I'll show that in the labs. And then whatever root user and pass you've defined here. And then we will connect to the MinIO service so you can access the MinIO web console by entering the http://yourhostip, or if you have mapped it to DNS, you can use that as well. But that is the host that the Docker container is running on, 9090, in your preferred browser, and any traffic that's pointed at that will then be redirected into the container. And you can also log in with the MinIO root user and MinIO root password you defined in the environmental variable file. You can also access the MinIO deployment over a terminal shell using the MC client. And again, you'll notice at the bottom here that we're saying MC alias set. We're just calling this alias MinIO. That's arbitrary. You can call it something more descriptive if you like, just so you know exactly what you're communicating with. And then we're again pointing at the host IP and 9000, which is the API port, and providing it the username and password that we defined in the environmental variable file. So that's it for the slides portion of this. In the next video, we will show you all of these things that I just discussed in a lab environment. So I look forward to seeing you there. Thanks, and have a good one.